everyone. Today it is the June 19th Committee on Community Resources meeting. We are being audio and video recorded, and Pam, will you please call the roll?
Councilor Shara?
Here.
Councilor Carney?
Present.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Here.
And Councilor Bidwell is not here and not coming. He is on a trip for 2 weeks. But we have quorum, so we're going to get started. We do have public here today, so I'd invite anyone here from the public who'd like to provide public comment.
Sure.
To come up to the podium, state your name and address.
Okay, I'm Laura Lozell, 46 Grant Avenue.
Vivian Miller, 32 Summit Street.
And we are here from the Human Rights Commission. Did you expect us to come? Okay, and I'm just going to give you this resolution that we have been working on, and
oh, I should give you a copy too.
Okay. I have to admit that at our last meeting, when we hammered out the final details of this, I was doing it remotely, and I kept getting cut in and out, so I'm not 100% sure why we're here. And do you know why? I mean, I don't know. I think we're asking you for support. Is that right? You were at the meeting, so you can
clarify. Yes, I think that would.
Let me just clarify. In public comment, unfortunately, we're not allowed to respond during public comment,
okay.
Which is why if you know you have something that you want to discuss with us, it's best to talk to us ahead of time and get it on the agenda.
Well, that's what I thought.
Then we can interact. But unfortunately, we don't interact during public comments. We can't answer questions. I apologize.
And we're not on your agenda.
You're not.
Okay. I thought that's the route we were going. So,
yeah. In the meeting, Karen said that she was going to be
okay.
In touch and get on the agenda.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Okay, so somehow it slipped through the cracks that we need to put on the agenda. So we'll just do it now.
Yes.
And basically, so this is a two-page thing. And can I just like explain to you what
Please.
Is going on?
Sure.
So. We've been talking about this for a few months after some meetings with the police chief and some other things that we've been hearing about an increase in not illegal behavior, but nasty behavior that might be considered biased speech, nothing that rises to the level of anything criminal. And we decided maybe the Human Rights Commission could do something to just sort of raise the conversation about how to behave with each other in a more respectful way. So what we came up with is this resolution supporting the culture of civility in the city of Northampton. And it's a short resolution followed by a pledge that we have this idea of trying to get as many people, public officials, regular residents, community leaders, appointed, elected, whoever feels so moved to sign this pledge, and then just do some work to get it disseminated and educate the public about the need to be respectful to each other. If it would be helpful, we could read it.
Sure, go ahead.
Okay.
All right. Whereas there has been an increase in Northampton and around the country of bias-motivated name-calling and language that demeans people based on who they are and where they are from. Whereas the New York Times, Boston Globe, and other national media outlets around the country have responded to this increase by inviting people to report such incidents. Whereas we wholeheartedly support freedom of speech as the cornerstone of a healthy democracy, we also believe that respect for each other is as vital to a healthy community as is the preservation of free speech. Go ahead.
Whereas we believe speech that denigrates people for who they are, even if legally protected speech, undermines the sense of safety of those who are targeted and also tears the fabric of a civilized, respectful community. Whereas we believe the responsibility for creating a community climate respectful to all falls not with the police or other law enforcement authorities, but with every single one of us who commits to respecting each other and standing with people targeted by hate slurs when we witness them. Now, therefore, be it resolved that in this city, we believe everyone has a right to feel safe walking down the street. Be it further resolved that while we protect free speech, we believe with free speech comes a responsibility. Be it further resolved that we call upon all people in the Northampton community to commit to not utter hate speech, including racist slurs, homophobic name-calling, sexist catcalls, and other forms of personal degradation.
Be it further resolved that free speech is not a license to demean other members of our community, to threaten the safety of individuals and the security of the community as a whole. Be it further resolved that if we witness such incidents, we will not ignore it, because the responsibility for a respectful and civilized community falls upon each one of us. Be it further resolved that the Human Rights Commission invites all members of the Northampton community to join in a civility pledge signifying an intention to not demean other people and to stand against such acts when witnessed.
And then the pledge is simple. Bias incidents and acts of hate destroy the fabric of our community, threaten the personal and collective safety of residents and visitors to our city, and can escalate into criminal activity. I pledge to commit to supporting a civil Northampton by refraining from disparaging other people based on who they are and standing with those who are the targets of such acts in a community effort to neutralize bigotry and support people who are marginalized and disenfranchised. And the thought was that we would try to roll this out, I think, starting in September, but we would spend the summer trying to get support from various city council subcommittees and the city council. And it was suggested that we start here. So I wish you had put on your agenda, because then we could be talking about it, but maybe you can put it on your agenda for another meeting.
Yes, thank you. I apologize for that. I'm sorry if I missed.
Oh, I don't think you did. I think it was on our end.
I'm sorry. Our next meeting, we meet in July, we don't meet in August, but we'd love to have you come back.
July?
Third Monday in July.
Okay, third Monday. Okay.
Exact date, it is the 17th. We would love to put this on the agenda and have you come back and discuss it.
Okay.
On the 17th.
And just a point of procedure. You can't talk about it tonight in new business?
We could bring it up, but generally we try not to, because it just, you know, for the reason that we want things to be posted on the agenda before we discuss them is that in case anyone else would like to talk about it, you know, they wouldn't know that we were discussing this. So
okay. So then I was asking because we would stay if you were taking it up under new business, but if you won't, then we won't stay.
I feel like in new business, maybe we'd further discuss putting it on the agenda, but I'm not sure that I want to do a substantial conversation just because since it wasn't on the agenda. I apologize. Yeah.
No, that's okay. Would you want one of us to say in case you have questions, though?
Do you feel like if we cover this in July, that will be too long a time?
I don't think so.
No? Then I'd rather we ask questions in July, if that's okay.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
When's our city council meeting?
It's the
15th. It's before
the 13th.
Because one of the issues, and I know we're not supposed to be back and forth, and although I think the committee were often a little more lax about that, is that my understanding from the Human Rights Commission as liaison for the city council is that the Human Rights Commission was going to ask members of this committee to sponsor it on the council floor so that it could be a joint resolution of the council and the commission. And so if they wait until the 17th, we'll miss our July, because we only have one city council meeting in July, which is unusual, but it's a summer schedule. So there's a timing issue there that we would hear from them, a request maybe to co-sponsor, we would be able to bring it back to the council until August, which might not be too late.
I mean, the point is transparency. You know, we can talk about it at the next meeting here, and also at the city council.
I mean, if we wanted to have it come right on the floor of the city council in our 13th, is it the 13th? Meeting,
yes.
It wouldn't have to come from this committee. It could
Well, they could approach counselors individually to host, to sponsor it. But I think the idea was that they were hoping for the co-sponsorship of this committee together with the Human Rights Commission.
And is that possible tonight under new business? Could we do something like that?
And what's your understanding of the limitations of new business?
Well, if it's something that you're going to be voting on, then I wouldn't recommend having a discussion. If it's something that you would like to have the committee, you know, the preferred approach would be for the resolution to come to City Council and be referred out to the Committee on Community Resources, even if you don't have the sponsorship, and then the sponsorship could be added to the resolution once it came to committee and after you guys have discussed it. I'm not sure if the plan is to have the mayor be one of the co-sponsors.
We could ask. We were busy fine-tuning the resolution itself, so we didn't totally map out a plan. But yeah, it seems like the mayor would be a good person.
Well, the reason why I ask is because I did receive a phone call about a resolution that was out there. No one seemed to know. This could be it, I don't know, but the mayor, there was some question about the mayor being a part of it, and he wanted to review it prior to it coming to City Council so that he had a full understanding and appreciation of, you know, what the elements were and what his involvement and
participation. And you know, was this resolution?
What's that?
You know that it was this resolution someone was calling about?
I don't know that, but I know that I want to say that Councilor Dwight and Councilor Klein's name were
I suspect it was a David R. Bikeman that called you?
No, it was the mayor's office.
Oh, the mayor. So they had heard, okay, because there's somebody else who approached me about something similar, and I told him about this resolution. He was going to try and hook up with it in some way, and maybe, so I was just thinking, maybe that's how it all.
Well, like I said, I'm not sure that this was the one that was being referred to.
I don't think so, because we didn't make a plan about that.
Okay,
so.
All right, and so, the only reason why I suggested that was because you have submits to the mayor and City Council. So I think the preferred approach would be, again, to have it go to City Council without the sponsorship of the committee, have it come to committee, and then the committee act yourself as sponsors.
The other option would be to schedule an additional meeting, right?
You could do that.
Or they could approach counselors individually. They don't necessarily need to get this committee as a committee.
Well, it sounds like
commission.
It sounds like we could go to the next city, ask to be put on the agenda for the next city council meeting, and then if it gets referred out to this committee, you can decide whether you want to sponsor.
Yes.
We were just trying to follow proper procedure, so we thought we should start with you first. But we'll go to the city council. And where does it say the thing about the mayor?
On the back side?
Oh, the plan. Oh.
And it would come as, but it would come as recommended by the Human Rights Commission, because, you know, there are so many people who can make, you know,
yeah, well,
present something for the City Council, and it would have to be coming from the Human Rights Commission.
Right, it says that.
Yeah, so, and the idea was, the plan is like the unofficial part of it. It's like our plan of action kind of thing, so, yeah, if we submit it to the mayor and he wants to sign off, we'd be happy, the more the merrier. We're into having as many people as possible. So I think I should ask to be put on the city council agenda for the next meeting, which is what the date?
You said the day of the council meeting? It's the 13th.
Of July?
Of July.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, so we'll figure it out. We'll get it to the mayor, we'll get it to the city council, and then it might make its way back to the city.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So there's no other public comment. Yes.
You want me to close the window?
Well, are you not feeling it?
I'm not feeling it.
Okay. Pam, are you going to be able to hear the recording?
What's that?
Are you going to be able to hear the recording?
For the rain?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we'll be fine.
So let's move on to the next item, which is approving the minutes from May 15th.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
So then moving on to what we have referred to us is 17.265, in order to build it to taxing vehicles for hire. So, to refresh everyone's memory, we talked about this two meetings ago. Then there were questions that we had for the solicitor and for the city clerk, and we have there, and then at our last meeting, we didn't discuss it because we had not received responses. We now have those responses. So we're going to discuss that ordinance today with the hope of moving it forward to really await it elsewhere. So Pam gave us, it's a little bit confusing because we have a few different copies of it. So we have the original copy of it. We have the red line version, which is, those are the changes that came, that we asked Pam to work on, that she sent forward to the solicitor and to the clerk. Then we have a copy with the solicitor's changes and comments. Do you have that, Councilor Simon? And then additionally, we have an email from the clerk with her comments on it. So, starting, I think it probably makes more sense to start with Solicitor Seawald's copy, because that has the red line changes already incorporated in and just has his additional changes and his comments. So, starting with that, first of all, Pam, do you have anything that you want to add or to sort of set up the conversations that you've been having with the two of them? Or?
Well, everything that I got came in written form.
Okay.
So there's really, we didn't really have a conversation per se. But I think Solicitor Seawald has, you know, a couple of changes that he introduced. And, you know, as a result of the initial copy that I sent him. So I don't think so.
Okay. All right, so I guess just starting the first thing with that, he deleted or changed in that under taxi cab to exceed the manufacturer's recommended seating capacity. And then he has a comment in here that says, no vehicle hired to exceed the recommended seating capacity. And he asked whether we need to set a number for that.
And he suggested 8 question marks, right?
He did suggest 8 question marks. I guess it depends on the vehicle. I have no idea.
That's the thing, it seems nonsensical to me because they're all different sizes. And so why did we set a number? And what if it's one of those like really long companies?
I think unless it's not to exceed 8 or something like that.
What do you think?
Unless it's not to exceed 8 or you know, more general number, but it's more inclusive.
I'm just confused about why we need that number. I don't understand the reason.
Yeah. I would agree. I'm not sure why we need that.
Before that, though, he deleted something. Is that above?
Yeah. Right, so we deleted all registrations require approval by the city council, after which a permit will be issued to the business owner. He deleted that, and instead it now says,
it's just deleted, but I don't recite it.
It's just deleted. Did that go on right after registration of vehicles?
Yeah.
Okay. It
might be useful to actually ask. Didn't we talk about that last time that we were going to ask him to do it? because it's hard to know what he was, what his rationale was behind the change of what.
So hard to be able to be here today.
Yeah, I don't know. He's basically taking out a step here.
I don't think he's taking out a step. I think if you look back on the original, I think he just deleted something that probably doesn't.
Just
erroneous, like I think it's on the red line version that I have, someone had added that in. Maybe he just thinks that that's not necessary.
Okay, so it wasn't in the original, it was added in.
Apparently he doesn't think it's necessary to put under, maybe because it's not a definition.
Okay.
That's what I would go with. It seems more like a requirement as opposed to a definition.
Okay. And then I would say for the question of needing the set capacity, can we just ask him if we legally need to do that?
Okay.
If not, that's not necessary. And then, is he asking, he says he's not sure what it means of the name insured. He's not sure what that means.
Right. Is it more sticking to the same person? The person who's getting a license also has to be the person who's actually insured for the vehicle maker.
Or is it the company that they have LLC?
Well, the company, yeah.
Right.
But it can't be like somebody else is holding the insurance for the registration, probably.
So what should we
do? Well, that's a question that he has because he didn't seem to offer any answer solution to that in his comments.
And that that's in the original?
He just added that comment after the red line version that we got from home.
Well, that's an original addition from the police department. So should we ask them what that means? Or
okay,
yeah.
What they were thinking. Was kind of
like,
yeah. But my thought is that it probably be the company whoever kind of owns it.
Right.
Right, because under livery vehicles it says buyer on behalf of the named insured or by an employee of the named insured. So it's just, I think it's language to ensure that it's the insured person
right.
or company, which it makes sense to me. So
I would say that it sounds, if you read the sentence thoroughly, probably the named business.
Yeah, it's got to be better for whatever the LLC is. And you could clarify that by writing the name of business, or you could just know that that's what that means.
That's a very long sentence, that entire definition is long sentence. Needed motor vehicle with a seating capacity not to exceed the manufacturer's recommended seating capacity, displaying on its exterior permanently painted or detail identification markings, a light affixed to the roof of said vehicle, and a taxi registration number plate issued by the Massachusetts Registry of Motor Vehicles operated for hire by or on behalf of
the business. It's going to be whoever the LLC is. operating them.
All right, so leave
it as the name insured, but that's just knowing that that's what that clarified. I don't know that we need to actually change it to clarify that. I think that it as you read it, it's pretty self-explanatory.
Right, and if that phrase is used repeatedly,
it's in that same sentence for the end as well.
Yeah, you said name insured.
Do you want me to ask him if he would feel better about it being changed to business?
Sure.
Because he asked that? Sure, yeah. He seemed to indicate that it's pretty good.
Then on the next page.
Can we just look at something that you didn't comment on? The paragraph after the one we were just talking about, that says loaded vehicles. Here it says any limousine or other vehicle which is designed to carry 15 or fewer passengers. So I just think in terms of naming 8 as the number earlier, doesn't make sense, especially if it says 15 or fewer, because it seems to indicate that you could have a vehicle that can carry up to 15 people.
Right, but is that a distinction between taxi cab and livery that we're trying to make? Like taxi cabs can have.
Yeah, I don't think this putting in the 8 as he suggested is going to be. He's saying we need to set a number, but we already have a number set in this next clause of 15 or fewer. So we have to somehow clarify that. Why there would be a 15 or fewer in the next clause?
Yeah, I don't think that's what the designation difference is. Because this is saying anyone's in our vehicle is designed to carry 15 or fewer passengers. So he's talking about the livery that we're talking about, the taxis. Oh, it does differentiate, that's right. So there's taxi cab and livery.
Right, so two different.
So the taxi cabs would, as if we were to keep this clause in there, carry fewer than 8. And livery fewer than 15?
Well, 15 or fewer, so this would be 8 or fewer, perhaps?
Yeah, that you could fall under the livery category if you had a limousine with 15 feet. I mean, are there vehicles that carry 15? Well, like vans and stuff.
Yeah. There are like giant limos.
That would have to be in the livery category then, according to this.
Right. So I wonder if that's why he said we need to set an amount.
Because it's more of a definition of what a taxi cab versus a livery.
Right.
And how do we determine, how do we find out what that standard is typically for taxi cab versus livery? Is it 8? I mean, he put the 8 question mark, and then we have to.
Well, like a minivan will see 8, right? 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2. And that would be the cutoff. That would be the largest vehicle that could be a taxi cab.
Maybe that's a standard that they have out there. I mean, if you knew, we should probably kind of be consistent if we.
I'm sorry, I was looking at the definition of limousine, and it just seems like we could do a better job on that definition.
You mean of livery?
Oh, that they have
livery. Yeah.
Well, it does say limousine, not livery.
Okay.
Yes, yeah. I'm sorry, I missed what you said.
Well, I was just saying we have this kind of thing that Alan put out there about an 8 question mark in terms of taxi cab, is that the standard versus the livery standard of 15 or fewer that they both, that we have in the language there? And I don't know how we find that out, whether.
Is there a way to determine if sort of taxis or standards do 8 or less passengers and sort of one of the distinctions that a livery can be a larger?
We don't have that number in our taxi cab.
Well, we certainly, I can't think that you would want to set 8 maximum capacity and as a definition.
For a taxi?
For a taxi, because some cars don't take 8 passengers.
Well, then you say 8 or fewer.
Yeah, 8 or fewer.
Oh, I see.
So.
Okay. You want to know?
No more than 8.
Okay.
Where so delivery is no more than 15.
It's 15 or fewer, the industry standard.
Or
15
or fewer,
the
industry
standard.
Standard
but the taxis, he put in the 8 question mark, and that might make sense. It might be what the industry standard is. But the taxi, I don't know why he wants us to put in that number, but for some reason he said we need to set a number.
I think it
I'm
makes
not sure why.
Sense, unless there is some sort of known vehicle that people use for taxis that takes more than 8
right.
people. I don't think so.
He might just be pointing out that that's something missing in our ordinance.
Just looking at New York City's definition.
Yeah. Okay, so anything else until we get to 316-17 business owner's permit? In that, so section A there, he's deleted, so it says no person, and he's deleted firm or, so now it says no person, corporation, or other entity based in Northampton shall operate a taxi cab or livery business within the city of Northampton. And then,
it sounds like he just made these all more readable.
Right.
In this in this one section with all the deletions.
Right.
5 of them.
Right. So in that previous sentence, it's city of Northampton without a permit. He's taken out unless the owner of said business has obtained. And just to simplify it, says without a permit as provided herein. Permits may be granted to suitable persons, corporations, or other entities who are the legally registered owners of said taxi cabs or livery vehicles.
Here it doesn't say anything about being insured. For the, when this is a business.
Business owner's
it's a permit. Yeah.
Right.
Then in the next section, section B, so it says here, any person desiring to operate such a business within the city of Northampton shall file an application with the city clerk for referral to the city council setting forth the name and residence of the owners of said business. And he comments here that this should be forwarded to NPD for investigation. Probably need owner's name, address, telephone number, social security number, date, and place of birth. So he thinks that what we have here is not sufficient to just ask for the name and residence, that we need more information than that.
Is there
what
looking
for know?
Like a criminal check?
Do you know what we've been doing so far, Pam? With anybody with a taxi cab, have they already had to submit things like their
Remember that this is the business permit. This is not the
right.
taxi driver.
Right.
And it's not the taxi.
Right.
So the city clerk has been using the business certificate, the DBA.
Right.
As the business permit, and we've never done this business permit before with a background check and everything else. That's
right, we haven't coordinated in any way with NPD to
right.
find out. So Alan is recommending that we have somehow some language that requires coordination between the city clerk and the police department. Yeah.
And that we, so the goal is to do a background check.
Well,
and therefore
that's
we'll need.
That's what this committee said it wanted the last time we met. So that's why we need all this additional information.
Okay.
So the permit is actually your issuing the permit, and remember further along in this there will be the opportunity
taxi company drivers or whatever, the business, this business permit can be pulled and can be
suspended,
yes. And then with the EDA, with the fictitious name that's been filed and being used as a business permit, you would not be able to do that.
Except if we're asking for a background check and we're not identifying what they're looking for or what would disinclude somebody or disallow for someone to get the business permit, we're creating a situation where it's completely subjective when the police look at it, look at the background check.
Well, they do that already with the drivers.
So are we, but then we should say it's a quarry check or whatever, what the standards are. We have to have some standard by which the police are making a recommendation or a disrecommendation.
Is there a taxi quarry check?
Is there a driver?
Yes.
So there's a standard for a taxi cab driver background check, whether it's moving violations or...
Moving violations, felonies, police record.
So somebody with a felony wouldn't be able to get a business permit in this city?
Would not be able to get a business owner's permit to run a taxi company.
Yeah, I don't know if I actually support that.
That might be already on the book right now.
It might be for a driver, though, which is different than a business owner.
And I think it's just the driver, because we had a case where somebody, the owner, the business owner himself, had some legal problems, but he was able to register his business and have other drivers doing that.
So again, then we would have to define why we would submit an application for a business permit to the police. What are the police looking for, and what would make them ineligible, and what wouldn't? Because if they're going by the same standards as a driver, then that means that we're disbarring something.
Situation come up before, and although the business owner himself had some legal problems,
yeah,
he was able to register his taxi cab business with other drivers.
I hear that, but
yeah,
the problem is with this, and we're asking for all of this information because it's going to be submitted to the NPD. What is the NPD looking for in that information?
I think they're just looking for info on the drivers.
Except we're talking about the business permit.
No, so if a business permit were denied, then there's the built-in component where a denial would be referred to the city council for
appeal. And that would come, we figured that out, that's going to come to this committee, right? Wasn't there something, whether it would be city services or this one?
Right. But I want to understand what the grounds for denial would be in submitting this new information that previously hasn't been submitted to the police.
Yeah.
That's
well,
my question.
Well, that's for the committee to decide.
Do we have standards set down? Do we have something? I mean, I guess we have this past practice and precedent. We can look back and see what we looked at for previous appeals that came to the city council subcommittee. It's only that one example I can think of that's Cosmic now, where we could pull out the old minutes. I mean, I don't remember what exactly were the standards and what were the circumstances.
So can I ask a question? So he's saying that it should, so it's not, as written already, it doesn't say that this information gets forwarded to NPD. This is his recommendation that it gets forwarded to NPD. And we are inferring that the reason that he says it should be forwarded to NPD is for a background check? But we don't actually know that. Or
yeah, he's just, it's
we
a
don't
comment,
have his
it's
reason.
A comment that he puts in to, in addition to name and residence of voter commissions, he also wants it at that point, putting forward the MPD, but we don't really need to consider that.
Does that mean that when someone applies for a business permit currently, that information is not being sent to the MPD?
Apparently not.
They don't apply for business permits. They apply for business DBA, doing business.
This is a new thing we're creating.
See, what was happening was the business owner permit was always in this ordinance. But the city clerk was interpreting the business owner permit to be the DBA, which is totally different. The DBA is setting up your fictitious name for your business. It doesn't allow the city council to revoke or suspend a license or a permit, I should say. And then there's also different things like this. This document says business owner permits are done every year. DBAs are done every 4 years.
Doing business as.
Yes. Yes. What was always, you know, being used for the business owner's permit.
So we were taking what we had already as a standard for the doing business as,
right,
DBA, and we were transferring that to other things, for example, this text.
I mean, you could even say you don't want a business owner's permit at all. You don't, if that's not the way that you want to go, then you should probably ask Attorney Sewell what the implications of that are.
It's just helpful to know what the present practice, what we're doing now. And it sounds like what we're doing now is not going anything to the MPD.
Right.
Looking for further detailed information on the DBA.
Right.
We're using the DBA strictly as it's been submitted. And we get the same comment.
This thing called a business certificate.
It's
just asks for the name, where the business is conducted, the name of the owner, the residence, they sign it, and then it gets notarized down below at the city clerk's office. I mean, if that's all you want for the business permit, then...
Well, that's what we have now, is what's helpful to know.
Yeah.
That's what we need to
catch
all
the time. And just process through the city clerk's office, it comes to us. There's no kind of background check that's done or anything along those lines. So, Attorney Sewell is now suggesting that some kind of background check is done. That's weird, as you said, we're inferring that we would end up saying essentially that we want a background check done. That's why it would go to the MPD. So then I'm saying if it's going to the MPD for some kind of background check, then it seems like we would have to create some kind of standard for what they're looking for and what might make someone ineligible.
Or we could leave it as is and not forward to the MPD.
I mean,
this is just, we don't have any further explanation from Attorney Sewell of why he would want to make this change in practice now.
Right. And so I just wanted on record that I'm uncomfortable with that idea, if it means that it's a background check. The only way that I would feel comfortable saying yes, we're forward to MPD is if we actually create standards by which a person will be judged for their eligibility for getting a permit or not, because I wouldn't support, for instance, not being able to give a permit to someone because they have a past felony conviction.
That's
what I'm trying to do.
Just to kind of go back, the reason we're even discussing this permit is because it's the language that came in the initial ordinance, and I think, Kim, you pointed out, this doesn't actually exist. This is not how we do it right now, right? We do the DBA. Therefore, if we're going to do that, we need to create a new system around it, right? So that's just sort of the background on it.
And we don't have Attorney Sewell here to say, is there any legal reason why we should be considering forwarding this to the MPD? Are we held liable in some way if we issue a permit to someone who we find out did or does X, Y, Z? So we don't, other than his little red comment here, we don't have any information about why he suggests that.
Okay. So.
Can we leave that as a something to follow up with Attorney Seawald? If he feels, if he has some strong rationale for why he wants us to amend the policy to include this, but otherwise we'll move on to the next recommended deletions or comments?
I'm fine with that. But from here, it's going to go to Legislative Matters. So that would probably be answered by him in Legislative Matters.
Yeah, then okay I would give us with the comments that Councilor Klein just put forward, it would be relevant for Legislative Matters to take on.
We should also keep in mind that this came from the police, the wording, and so if they didn't ask for that step, we don't necessarily need to have that in there.
It's always been in the ordinance.
That it goes back to them?
That it goes to the MPD?
When you say that came from the police.
No, she means the step of gathering the information, then sending it on to the MPD.
Yeah, she's talking about the whole background check to bring city clerk, sent it to the MPD and all that. That's new. That's a new recommendation.
That's being suggested first by him right now. I mean,
by attorney
recently.
Yeah, it's not something we can do.
And the police themselves didn't ask for it.
And the police didn't ask for it.
Right. But they created this permit, although it's not really clear whether they knew they were creating a new entity or not when they were doing it. Is that what you said?
They were trying to address a particular problem.
Right. Okay, so that's another question for the solicitor that we'll get answered.
But if he can understand the rationale for the questioning, our questioning, that would probably be useful. You know what I mean? Just the concern about what we would have to read the parameters for what they're actually looking for at the police, if they were to do that. It's like apocalyptic out
there. Okay, so moving forward from there, on the next page, section D, upon being denied an operator permit by the chief of police, an applicant shall have the right of appeal to the Committee on Community Resources. Looks like there should be a space between the and the committee.
Where are you?
I'm sorry, I'm on, I don't know page numbers, but I'm on,
Section D.
Section, so, 316-18, Section D. The next, yeah, the next sort of bunch of comments or deletions come out. So we could add a space between the committee, community resources, all such appeals shall be in writing and filed with the Committee on Community Resources within 10 days of the denial of the operator's permit. Appeals will be heard at the next regularly scheduled meeting of the Committee on Community Resources. The decision of the Committee on Community Resources shall be final and binding.
Those all seem just really
scrivener's
more than anything else.
I don't know if going forward we should talk about what, you know, parameters that we have for that appeal process or what that should look like or not, but I guess we have some amount of time, but it would be good if that was discussed in committee what our expectations for an appeal process would be.
And we should look at what we already have in practice, because we have been hearing these appeals on the Committee on Civil Services.
Okay.
Well, Committee on Public Safety. So it goes back to, it's 2 years.
Okay.
Cosmic having the most recent.
Okay, so that would be good to review that and see if we want to see how that process works. Okay, section E, it shall be the duty of the driver of any vehicle for hire to accept as passengers any person who seeks to use the service of a vehicle for hire, provided that such person is not intoxicated and conducts him slash herself in an orderly fashion. His comment is, don't we want intoxicated people to take cabs?
Well, I just think it's a no. I mean, what are we supposed to, I mean, it seems not unreasonable for someone to say that, you know, if somebody's going to be really off the wall intoxicated in a taxi cab.
Maybe intoxicated is not the right word to use.
What about just getting rid of that and saying it conducts himself in an orderly fashion?
Yeah.
Because I agree with that in the spirit, that idea that I'm trying to encourage people to call
it out. But if someone's disorderly, then...
Right.
Okay, so let's delete...
Intoxicated.
Not intoxicated.
As such person conducts him or herself in an orderly fashion.
Yeah.
Good point.
You feel like orderly, like, covers it, orderly and respectful fashion?
Yeah, because orderly is kind of, you know, there's drunk and disorderly, okay. You know, I mean, so there's...
It's illegal.
I mean, if someone is throwing punches and whatever else, then it
okay. Be
considered disorderly.
Okay. So, you think that's fine, just taking out his non-intoxicated and?
Yeah.
Okay, moving on.
Loud and importunate. Is that the next one, MG?
Yeah, I think it was just the space that you moved.
Yeah.
That's why you know.
Importunate.
It's like forceful. It's so funny because in the Middle East, that's exactly what they do. They drive up down the streets and they're like, hey, what did that do? So we don't do that here in Northampton.
H. So no vehicle for hire shall be used for transportation for hire of any. Wait, what? No vehicle for hire shall be used for the transportation for hire of any alcoholic beverages or alcohol. Well, that's good.
There's no deletion in that section. I think it was just G and I. G just.
No, he deleted the comma without a comma.
Yeah, it's commas. Right.
Without a carrier's, common carrier's license, so he deleted without a common carrier's license issued by the Department of Public Utilities and without a permit issued by the Alcohol and Beverage Control Commission as required, Chapter 138, Massachusetts General Law is amended. Okay, but does that make, first of all, that sentence needs a period at the end, but transportation for hire of any alcoholic beverages or alcohol?
I don't know what that means.
That feels redundant. B, how can an alcoholic beverage
I misplaced.
Right.
It's like you call the store and they load it in and it gets to the, you're supposed to bring it to the party or something.
Transportation for hire.
I think that is what it is, like that they're not going to be a delivery service for alcohol.
Okay, but what's the difference between alcoholic beverages or alcohol?
I think they're the same.
Is there solid alcohol? Is there?
You just fill the cab up with alcohol.
But then it stops being a beverage?
It's always a beverage.
Okay, so...
yeah, there's something wrong with that whole thing.
For any alcoholic beverages and just leave it at that?
Oh, I see. Why do they have any alcoholic beverages or alcohol?
Right, that's what I'm saying. It's,
I don't
seems
know.
Redundant.
I mean, well, I would leave it in case there's some reason that we don't know. I mean, why
illicit substances?
I mean, it's not something new we're adding.
It's very specific.
It's something that's always been. So, do we not? Is there some distinction between an alcoholic beverage and alcohol? Unless, you know, is grain alcohol, straight alcohol, not considered a beverage? Is it, you know, are those distilled beverages?
Like you couldn't call and get Sterno delivered.
For like rubbing alcohol.
Rubbing alcohol.
Like the malt liquor.
Some of those might not be considered an alcoholic beverage, but like more medicinal. And maybe, you know, I mean, I know that actually a lot of those, I mean, because there was a number, remember when they used to have the blue laws and you couldn't get alcoholic beverages, except you could at a pharmacy get some of the distilled beverages. Not beverages, but liquors, like, you know, they would let me come in on a Sunday when it was.
This is probably a holdover from really old language or something.
Well, so first off, so I mean, as originally written, if you had a permit issued by Alcoholic Beverages Control Commission, you could do it. So he's taking that out.
So you're on to the next one.
Yeah.
No, that this is all part of it. So that the second half of, if you go to the original, that's the second half of that confusing sentence, is it was hire for of any alcohol beverages or alcohol without a common carrier's license issued by the Department of Public Utilities and without a permit issued by the Alcoholic Beverages Control Commission as required by Chapter 138 Mass General Law.
And we don't know why he deleted that.
Right. So the first question is, why did he delete that? And the second question is, can we make this a better sentence?
Yeah. So it was H, is it H or I?
Well, it
H.
Is H.
Okay.
That's why I was confused, because I thought that deletion was from I.
Yeah, it's hard to tell where they go to.
So what he's saying, I mean, where we have it qualified in our original language about transportation of alcoholic beverages or alcohol,
right.
He wants us to get rid of that because we said if they had a common carrier's license.
Right, so it's saying you just can't do it.
Yeah, he wants us to just say no, we can't transport.
Right. Which,
except I think this whole thing about a common carrier's license, Department of Public Utilities, I don't know why the Department of Public Utilities specifically, but what if there is like a package store that has a delivery service?
Well, they wouldn't be, they wouldn't fall under this ordinance.
This is taxi cab.
Yeah. And what he's saying is that you can't use a taxi cab or livery to get.
You can't call up the package
right.
store and say,
right.
send
yeah.
the taxi cab to pick it up. But actually, yeah. And he's saying, here, he's just getting rid of that other language that allowed it if you had.
So maybe no vehicle for hire shall be used for the transportation for hire of any alcoholic beverage or other illicit substance. I think is what you would say before.
Here.
Shall be used for.
I think we should just say.
Shall be hired for the transportation of any alcoholic beverages or other illicit substance.
He's not saying that. I mean, it's very specifically about alcohol. So.
Yeah, I think, especially if
that,
there's a reference
that opens
to the
it up
ADCC.
To a whole what's an illicit substance. I mean, that,
yeah,
that's
yeah,
a much
yeah.
broader
no,
legal
no,
question.
No vehicle for hire shall be hired for the transportation of any alcoholic beverage or alcohol.
Period.
All right.
Yeah, I don't feel invested in this.
Okay.
Qualifier.
Right. It's been a long time because of that. Okay, but add a period at the end there will be two. Okay, so moving on to the next page. So J, I think it's J. Basically, it's a J. It shall be unlawful for any driver of vehicle for hire while on duty to drink any intoxicating beverage, to utter profane or obscene language, to disturb the peace of the passenger, or it's like
to be impolite is what he took away.
It's deleted, or to be impolite, or to smoke while transporting any passenger. So first, he deleted to be impolite, which to accept that deletion, we need to take out one of those ors.
Yeah, that's worth getting rid of. You don't want to have polite and impolite in it.
I mean, I would say profane or obscene language is fairly subjective.
Right.
Also, but.
Yeah.
But everyone's okay with that?
I'm okay with it.
Like the keeping for Dana in language.
Well, it's saying that it's the driver of the vehicle
right.
on duty to be other than propane or obscene language, just other abuse.
You could get rid of obscene language because it says to disturb the peace, and because it's so subjective, like,
yeah, I'm fine with that.
Someone were to,
too, yeah.
Yeah, someone were to file a complaint that you'd be given or whatever, then it could be a more subjective decision.
Where it says, while on duty, to drink any intoxicating beverage, comma, get rid of that next phrase to utter profane or obscene language, but keep to disturb the peace of any passenger.
To disturb the peace of the passenger.
Oh, no,
yeah, you're right. Okay. Disturb the peace of the passenger or just not touch it.
I mean, it's all subjective, right?
Yeah.
Disturbing the peace is very, I mean, disturbing the peace is very. I don't feel strongly, so let's take out a profane and obscene language.
Yeah, I'm fine with that.
Okay, so drinking intoxicating beverage, and then we go right to disturb the peace of passenger, or take out one or, and then or to smoke while transporting any passenger.
Technically, grammatically, you don't need the twos. To drink any intoxicating beverage, disturb the peace of the passenger, or smoke while transporting any passenger.
Okay. Then there is no change until A1 is the permits for vehicles, and that seems to be a technical number change. I don't know enough about it to have an argument with that challenge. Okay, so then moving on to the next. This is the end of number 2, which is about insurance. I'm going to read the whole thing, the questions. No permit shall be issued until the applicant has delivered to the city clerk a policy of insurance issued by an insurance company authorized to transact business specified in subdivision B of the 6th clause of subsection 47, chapter 175 of general laws, covering the motor vehicle to be operated by the applicant under his or her permit conforming to provisions of subsections 1, 12, and 113 of said chapter 175, nor until the applicant has also delivered to the city clerk a certificate of the insurance company issuing the policy, showing that the policy shall not be canceled without giving the city clerk 10 days notice thereof. Such policy shall be a policy of liability insurance which provides indemnity for or protection to the insured, and any person responsible for the operation of the insured vehicle which is expressed or implied, his slash her express or imply or their preference? That it is her?
Where are you reading?
I'm
trying to follow along.
I'm mid number 2.
Yep. Okay, so it's in the.
So
not,
it says his
not
express
comment.
Or implied consent. I'm taking issue with saying his. I was saying his or her. Now I'm wondering whether we should not make
there's
gender.
There's a previous consent. Place where we have a slash
right.
Male, female thing. And so we should
be consistent. Well, so do we have a preference? Do we want to do his slash her here or go back and globally change it to non-gender language? Anyone care?
I think it's more correct these days to do there.
Yeah, I would agree. Let's do it.
So the place before, I think I can remember where it was because I thought about myself at the time. We put that up. Search.
Okay. Oh, here it is. Section E. Under, it was the intoxicated people taking taxi cabs section. So, conducts.
And actually, so we're in 2 now, right?
Yeah, but I'm going back to
it. Yeah,
I'll get that. Conducts
their self?
Themselves.
Themselves. Okay.
So could say oneself.
Oneself?
It's not investing. That's
one self. You have to make sure, should conduct oneself. You have to make sure everything's singular.
Yeah.
Okay, so this person conducts themselves.
Such person conducts themselves.
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 Such person conducts themselves.
Yeah, themselves.
Themselves.
Because it's a person. Yes. Such person.
Provided that
singular.
Such person conducts themselves in an orderly fashion. I feel like Pam changed that correctly like 10 minutes ago and is just letting us do this. Just letting us struggle through it. Thanks, Pam. Okay, so back to the insurance. Any person, okay, with their foreign, no, I better read the again. Such policies shall be a policy of liability insurance which provides indemnity or protection to the insured and any person responsible for the operation of the insured vehicles with their, oh, express or implied consent. Against loss by reason of the liability to pay damages to others for injury, to property or bodily injuries, including death at any time resulting therefrom, sustained during the term of said policy by any person other than the employees of the insured or of such other person responsible as
aforesaid.
Thank you. We're entitled to payments or benefits under the provisions, Chapter 152 of General Laws, arising out of the ownership, operation, maintenance, control, or use upon the ways of the Commonwealth of such car to the amount or limit of at least $100,000 on account of injury to or death of any one person and subject to such limits as respects injury to or death of one person or at last $300,000 on account of one accident resulting in injury to or death of more than one person and to the amount or limit of at least $25,000 on account of any one accident resulting in damage to property. So,
he says these might be low, but I think that last should be a least. Right before the 300,000?
Of at least, that would make a lot more sense for the sentence. Yes, I think that should say of at least $300,000.
Since it also says at least of
right.
The next 2.5.
I think that's correct. So, Pam and I talked about this. We don't know what the standards are for taxis or liveries in terms of insurance, whether they are the same as one's personal vehicle or whether they tend to have higher premiums or I don't know. So, or
we need to do some research.
So
these numbers are what we have on the books right now. And
right.
He's just suggesting that they may be low based on
well, we don't know
time since we last passed this. Or
I don't know why he thinks they might be low other than he's musing about it. So, again, this would be, as this goes forward to legislative matters, we could leave it as is. We could ask him why I think so, although I would imagine he would say because he's concerned that they are.
I would leave them as is and let those questions come up in legislative matters for why he, I mean, to see if he addresses those particular.
The one thing I would say, though, here is that we have to be thoughtful about what, because your premium will go up the higher the,
right.
The amount,
right.
What is going to be prohibited for new business owners. Taxi services, you know, and you don't want to make it prohibitive for people to, you know, do some entrepreneurial venture opening up a new taxi service.
And livery.
Yes.
And livery.
Maybe.
And so these were already the, okay, hold on, I'm sorry, I'm trying to find where they are here. These were already in the ordinance?
They were.
So these were not additions by?
No.
And I wonder if it differs where you're driving. Like if in New York, it
right.
makes sense
have
to have
difference.
Much higher insurance policies than in a city like Northampton. It seems like a call to an insurance company to clarify this fairly quickly, kind of what this industry standard is, no?
For the region or area? Yeah, I would guess so. Otherwise, you could research what other sort of similar cities do, but yeah. Okay, so Pam, do you and I want to call some insurance companies?
I guess keeping in mind though that they want to make more money, so they might recommend higher policies.
Well, I mean, you could say like this is a yeah. But, you know.
They do have their recommended levels.
Right. Right.
I'm sure it can't be just based on them wanting to make more money. I'm sure it has to be based on some data about what's the average,
right.
you know, accident.
Right.
I would hope that these maybe.
Okay, we'll try.
Number three, there's a his. Whenever the chief of police or his designee.
Well, geez.
So that needs to change. That came up when I did my search.
Let's get rid of that.
Just make it her this one.
Currently correct, but probably not the best way to pull off. Their designee. Okay. What's this? So he's.
Yeah, there's nothing referenced at the bottom.
I don't know if there's something actually in the ordinance itself in the ordinance book.
That is that footnote.
Yeah.
All right, so I guess we all have the same question. That's what that is. And then that is it for his comments. Then we have Clerk Maz's comments, which some of them, a lot of this goes back to that what we were discussing before, which is about requiring requiring the gathered information for the business permit to go to the PD for a background check. And so she's sort of questioning how that process would work in terms of timing and whether you collect the money when they file or you wait until they pass the check so that you wouldn't then have to return the money if they don't pass the check. So those are sort of those are valid questions kind of within the whole discussion of how do we handle this permitting process and what's the purpose of sending it to the PD, particularly if it's going to then create this timing issue. So then and she asked about the meters. So she asked about who's going to make sure that they're complying with that requirement. Officer Allard was here, he said that the police would be, yeah, and they would respond to, that would be complaint-based?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So that's the answer to that. Then she's asking about the cost of livery license, the same as the taxi cab, is business owner permit also the registration of the vehicles, or is that another form for that? I would say it's a different form, right? I mean, it's a different process. And so to get the business permit is the same regardless of whether it's livery or a cab? Okay. She brings up insurance.
So we're not sure. I mean, she references the ordinance requiring the permit to go to the police department for background check, but we're not sure that we're not doing that presently, and we haven't determined it. And I think you could get more reasoning and rationale
right.
for that in legislative matters
right.
to deal with these specific questions that the clerk asks. Because without him here, I mean, we've been doing it without them being referred.
Right.
She's saying that if there's an addition now to conform with Alan's recommendations, that's going to be stuff that you have to put into place with some sort of, system for making sure that if you collect the money, how you're going to get back to them and all that. I mean, she's asking very specific questions about that.
Right. Which I think can be part of that discussion with him as to whether this is a necessary step, what's the purpose of that step, and if it is necessary, the corresponding pieces to it, how should those work? And then the insurance question. So the insurance section is for both livery and taxi. So there's no difference between them. What we're trying to do is change the, I mean, she points out what's been happening, which is that it's been far less expensive to operate a livery vehicle than a taxi cab, which is why we've had so many. So what we're trying to do is sort of eliminate that inequity between the two, which.
I really feel that that's a conversation that's best had with the insurance company to find out if they're the ones that are making those requirements. I mean, or state statute is making those requirements.
Right. Okay.
Don't you think? I mean, before. Determination that livery vehicle is a lot less costly to insure. I mean, is that based on the statute or is that based on the ordinance? Where is that, where's that coming from? Is it, do people think that liveries are a lot cheaper to insure because we don't have limits on it and therefore they just pick the lowest limit, the cheapest cost? I don't know the answer to that, so.
Okay.
But I think somebody at an insurance company would know, well, if you're getting livery plates, you're required to have, these limits, right? I mean.
Right, well, so for her question, she says that she thinks it should be clearly stated in the ordinance if they're required to carry the same insurance.
Well, I think it's probably implied.
Right, I mean, it's not saying
it's not explicit,
that.
But neither is any of the other stuff in there except for the title.
But some, there are places where there are distinctions made between livery and taxi cab. So if there is not a distinction being made between the two, then the implication is that it's for both.
Right, I think the only difference between the two is
everything is
required except for the markings on the taxi cab.
And they have to be, right. And livery cannot be hired on the air. Outside of 12-hour window. Right. So, I mean, what I'm saying is I feel like it's clear in here that they are the same requirements.
Definition of each is in different ways, everything in here is referring to both.
To both, right, exactly. And then then she's talking about section C, operation and marking of livery vehicles. There's no mechanism in place. She says there's no mechanism, if there's no mechanism in place, for monitoring the pre-completed schedule trip sheets and the minimum 12-hour notice, they'll be acting as taxi cabs as they are now. That too, Officer Allard had said that they were going to be in charge of monitoring those trip sheets, right? So, I mean, we can't stop people from trying to do what they're not supposed to do, but we do have mechanisms if they're caught doing it.
Well, I think in the giant scheme of things, if you look at what we have currently, there's only one vehicle for hire business in the entire city with six vehicles.
Right.
That's it. So you don't even have a livery business, but you did, and when they found out we were going to make them equal, they moved. So.
Okay. So any other questions or comments about the clerk's? No? Any other comments in general? Do we feel like there's still a bunch of things to be sorted out with the solicitor, but we're ready to move this forward to legislative matters?
I would move it forward with those comments that we talked about this evening.
And with the understanding that hopefully we can get the sort of a comment to legislative matters to address that.
Do we need to move this? Is that what you did?
I don't know. I mean, if you need to, it's a motion. If not, then
yes,
if
you do.
A motion.
Yes, a second to move it forward to motion.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. No abstentions or objections. Okay, so that finally leaves here and goes there. Luckily, I sit there too, so. Okay, I've lost my agenda and all of this stuff. Here we go. So moving on to the next item, we are skipping number five today, which is continuing the discussion concerning the op-eds. Councillor Bidwell and I had a brief conversation. He thought he might have a draft for us to look at while he's gone, but he didn't have any time, which is totally, said was completely fine. It's fine if they aren't running one a month. So we will hopefully discuss that at our next meeting. Now, update on the mayor's panhandling advisory group. I have this on the agenda because Councilor Bidwell he gave me a couple responses to questions that had come up at our previous meeting about the advisory group. He doesn't give me the questions, he just gives me the responses. I'm sure we can figure out what the questions were. He says, sorry, I have to sneeze. Thank you. It's not coming. So One thing he writes is, these meetings are not subject to open meeting law, as they are meetings called by the mayor, who is not a quote governmental body subject to open meeting law. So I guess that was a question we had about whether those were, fell under that. And the other response I have is, we had another conversation about bringing folks from, who are on the street into the group. There was a consensus that this would not be the best way to get their input. Rather, a subgroup is working on a survey instrument of some sort that will be used effectively, I think, to solicit input and recommendations from the perspective of various members of the disparate downtown on the streets community, end quote. So those were the two responses that he wanted me to share, based on the sort of the concerns and conversation that we had at our last meeting about that. So anyone have any further discussion about that or anything you want to talk about with that? No? Okay. So next item on the agenda is the summer schedule. July 17th is our next meeting, as we've already talked about. Begin discussion with arts organizations. We proposed this in May. To begin discussions with arts organizations in July. Does that sound familiar? Does that sound like what something we want to do? How, any ideas on how we want to proceed with that?
Well, we could start, just because when I met with Brian Foote, he said that he would be happy to come and talk to us and kind of give us a firsthand kind of recounting of everything they're working on, what they're struggling with, all that kind of stuff. This is stuff that I talked to him about in a one-to-one conversation. So it might make sense to see if he's available. July could be tricky, I suppose. And at that meeting, it might be useful to ask him, if he were to come, we could maybe ask him for his recommendations about who it might be strategic for us to talk to.
Okay.
But I think we have to be very thoughtful and sensitive about how we put any invitation forward, because he made very clear that, you know, he feels like they have all these meetings anyway and they're doing okay without us, and it's not really clear, you know, how the city council can help them, so why are we taking up their time? Just to say that we really want to hear from them. We talked about this in May. We want to hear from folks about concrete ideas that they might have about how we can help in any way with their work, if there is any way.
It is part of our charge as the committee to interact with city departments, such as for this committee.
Right, and Brian's very open to it, but I'm thinking about the other ones that aren't city committees, like the, you know, the Arts Trust or the Center for the Arts. Or
but just to be clear, we're talking about just inviting Brian in July. And then just sort of get his take on how to open up the conversation more, perhaps?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, we could do it and invite a bunch of different people. I think it might be useful not to have some of those other groups at the same time, to give them a little bit more berth to share their thoughts and feelings, and they might feel a little bit cramped in their ability to say certain things if we're here with the council.
Okay.
And we are.
So, start with Brian.
Yeah, but I'm really open to whatever you guys think.
That sounds fine. I mean, I think it feels sort of appropriate.
I think it's short notice too to get a hold of who can get Brian, and that's
right.
Yeah. So also, I'm just wary of doing something that could appear to be kind of summit-like once after Brian very specifically said, like, we don't, you know, need a summit per se.
Right.
So to do it more like individual informal conversations with people, you know, key people in the arts in the city, might make more sense.
Okay. And we want to phrase it as we want to talk about actual concrete ways that we could help.
As a committee, as a council.
Okay. Okay, we will see if Mr. Foote's available for that meeting. We don't have a meeting in August, then our next meeting after that is September 18th. And we'll also be adding to the July agenda, well, if it gets referred to us, we'll the resolution, but I'm just getting ahead of myself. Anyone have any new business?
Motion to adjourn.